Please stand if you're able. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Let us pray. O Lord God, you teach us that without love, our actions gain nothing. Pour into our hearts your most excellent gift of love, that, made alive by your Spirit, we may know goodness and peace through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please.
A reading from Acts. Now the apostles and the believers who were in Judea heard that the Gentiles had also accepted the word of God. So when Peter went to Jerusalem, the circumcised believers criticized him, saying, "Why did you go to uncircumcised men and eat with them?" Then Peter began to explain it to them step by step, saying, "I was in the city of Joppa praying, and in a trance I saw a vision. There was something like a large sheet coming down from heaven, being lowered by its four corners, and it came close to me. As I looked at it closely, I saw four-footed animals, beasts of prey, reptiles, and birds of the air. I also heard a voice saying to me, "Get up, Peter, kill and eat." But I replied, "By no means, Lord, for nothing profane or unclean has ever entered my mouth." But a second time the voice answered from heaven, "What God has made clean, you must not call profane." This happened three times, then everything was pulled up again to heaven. At that very moment, three men sent to me from Caesarea arrived at the house where we were. The Spirit told me to go with them and not to make a distinction between them and us. These six brothers also accompanied me, and we entered the man's house. He told us how he had seen the angel standing in his house and saying, "Send to Joppa and bring Simon, who is called Peter. He will give you a message by which you and your entire household will be saved." And as I began to speak, the Holy Spirit fell upon them, just as it had upon us at the beginning. And I remembered the words of the Lord, how he had said, "John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit." If then God gave them the same gift that he gave us when we believed in the Lord Jesus Christ, who was I that I could hinder God? When they heard this, they were silenced, and they praised God, saying, "Then God has given to the Gentiles, even to the Gentiles, the repentance that leads to life." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And now sing Psalm 148. A reading from Revelation. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And as I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "See, the home of God is among mortals. He will dwell with them as their God. They will be his peoples, and God himself will be with them. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more, for the first things have passed away." And the one who was seated on the throne said, "See, I am making all things new." Also he said, "Write this, for these words are trustworthy and true." Then he said to me, "It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty, I will give water as a gift from the spring of the water of life, the word of the Lord.
The Holy Gospel comes to us today from John, the 13th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. When Judas had gone out, Jesus said, "Now the Son of Man has been glorified, and God has been glorified in him. If God has been glorified in him, God will also glorify him in himself, and will glorify him at once. Little children, I am with you only a little longer. You will look for me, and as I said to the Jews, so now I say to you, where I am going, you cannot come. I give you a new commandment, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you also should love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another." This is the gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Please be seated, and I invite our young friends forward for the children's sermon. Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. I just have a couple of things I have to do. Think I'm counting days? No.
Weeks.
No, not counting weeks.
Years.
Not counting years.
Hours.
No. Yes. You know what I'm counting? I'm keeping track of all my mistakes. Don't you think that's a good idea? Make sure you keep track of all your mistakes. Don't you think that's a good idea? You don't keep a record book? No? No? Huh. You know what we do at the beginning of the worship service? What do we do at the very beginning? Confession. Confession and... what?
Forgiveness.
Yeah. Yeah. What's that about? That we can what?
We can confess to Jesus.
We confess to Jesus and he will forgive us. Absolutely. So even if you keep all those tally marks of what mistakes you've made, this is what Jesus thinks. Jesus just erases them, right? You know how these things work, right? You just slide the little lever and it erases it. Yeah, so... in our second reading today, we had Jesus telling us that God is making all things new. All things new. Does that mean your shoes are going to be new tomorrow? No. New dresses tomorrow? No. What does it mean? Well, one of the things God is making new, that Jesus makes new, is our hearts, right? Right? And when does that happen? When does that happen? when we're forgiven. Yes. Anybody out there feel like a new person after the forgiveness? After confession and forgiveness? Or do you sometimes keep your tally marks? Yeah, it's easy to keep our tally marks and remember what we did wrong. But Jesus wants to remind us that he's making our hearts new all the time. And that when we come to confession and forgiveness, that he wants us to feel new, to feel at peace, to feel renewed, to feel like we don't have to hang on to our tally marks of mistakes we've made. And we don't have to hang on to the tally marks of the people of the mistakes other people have made. Whoa. Anybody here hang on to those tally marks sometimes? Uh-huh. They're laughing because they know it's true. It's easy to hang on to tally marks, isn't it? It is so easy to hang on to tally marks. But what does Jesus say? I am making all things new, and you are forgiven. Each and every one of us here are forgiven, made new every Sunday morning during confession and forgiveness. Every time we take our tally marks to God, we're made new. Good stuff, right? Good news. You can have peace in your heart, right? Yeah. So let's pray. Dear Jesus,
thank you
for forgiving us.
So that we can be made new,
and we don't have to hold on to any tally marks.
Help us
to love other people
and
erase their tally marks too. Amen. Thanks for coming up. Have a good week. Have a good week. Let's pray. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and loving, thank you for this day. Thank you for bringing each and every one of us to this house of worship today, that we may with one voice, one heart, one mind, praise you and worship you. And now may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable to you. Amen. Oh, the gospel for today. Ah, love. Can you believe this? Can you believe this is the gospel reading appointed for the Sunday before my wedding? Love? How cool is that? The greatest commandment, to love. And what's that word? Have you heard this one? Being all Twitter-pated? Uh-huh. Yeah. Yes, that might be me. Silly in love. Today, love seems so easy to me. It seems like something that, how can you not be in love, right? But we only need to notice where this is in our gospel reading, where this love commandment sits, how it is spoken by Jesus, to know that it's a lot more complicated than pre-wedding Twitter-patedness. Today's gospel doesn't fully tell the truth about love because love is lifted out of its reality in our gospel. Love is theoreticized, it's commercialized, it's hypotheticalized, it's Twitter-paterized. But love, the love that Jesus is talking about, is hard. Because before what we call the love commandment in our gospel reading today, before that is the betrayal. Just before that, Judas leaves the room. Immediately after is the prediction of Peter's denial. Right smack dab in the middle is the love commandment. And sometimes I wonder what Jesus thought when he uttered these words, this command, after it was night and before the cock will crow. And yet Jesus washes the feet of both Judas and Peter. Jesus feeds both Judas and Peter, and then tells us to do the same. Love others. And love is not always so easy. Jesus, as the Word made flesh, knew how difficult love can be. From his mother insisting on him moving into ministry, to the death of his dear friend Lazarus, to Judas's abandonment, to Peter's denial of what Jesus knew he could be. Oh yes, Jesus knows. If we isolate just our gospel reading today, as the lectionary did today, if we isolate it from real life, then we turn Christianity into love without truth. We turn it into love without the incarnation, the God made flesh. It's an important moment this far out from Easter. Love is never without sacrifice. Love is never without hearts hurting. Real love knows what's on the other side of its most fulfilling, most wonderful moments. I think like that about love, as hard as it is. But because true love is real love, felt love, true love imagines the future. True love knows change. True love expects and accepts that nothing can stay the same. It's no accident that this injunction from Jesus occurs in what is called the farewell discourse. Things are about to change, big time. Jesus will hand himself over to be arrested. Jesus will be put on trial and crucified. Jesus will leave his disciples. And while his leaving is to prepare an abiding place for them with God and with himself, nonetheless, he is leaving. And transitions are excruciating. So we hang on to love, don't we? The love commandment is said in the midst of betrayal and denial, in the midst of departure and depression, in the midst of fear and unease. And so this is the nature of Christian love. It is a love aware of the consequences. It is a love aware of the challenges. But most of all, it is a love that loves anyway. A love that knows what it's getting into and yet loves abundantly. Otherwise, our love merely skims the surface of the gospel love, of God's love. It will be satisfied with the love of the world, a love that demands and decrees, a love that stipulates and insists on certain standards, a love that has convinced itself of a self-maintaining love, a self-preserving love, a self-love, a love unwilling to take risks, a sacred, a scared love, a safe love. Love one another as I have loved you, so also you should love one another. We tend to leave off that last sentence, making it easier. But Jesus does not let us off the hook. The demand to have love for one another surrounds Jesus' love for us. Or Jesus' love for us makes it possible to imagine loving one another on either side of Jesus' love. Regardless, the emphasis here is on loving one another. Yes, truly Jesus loves us. Truly Jesus loves us. And God loves the world. But as soon as we assume that this love is one directional, Jesus corrects us. His love means love for him and love for one another. This love is not just between you and Jesus. This love is for the sake of the world. Thanks be to God. Amen. Please stand as we confess our faith with the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God,
the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not. Came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and earth.
trusting in God's promise of new life, we pray for the renewal of the church, the world, and all of creation. Send your Holy Spirit upon your church. Awaken us to the renewed commitment of our baptismal promises, to build community, to worship together, to share our faith, to serve others, and to work for justice and peace. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Forgive us for the ways we have caused creation to suffer. Inspire creativity as we explore new ways of reducing our consumption of the earth's resources. Restore forests and waterways. Replenish the habitats of all endangered and threatened species. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Call all nations to the repentance that leads to life. Empower legislators to craft laws reflecting your commandments to love and serve. Bless police officers, firefighters, paramedics, and first responders who put themselves at risk to care for others. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Make your home among us and shelter us from the storms of death, mourning, crying, and pain. Draw near to those who weep and to those who are lonely. Restore health and wholeness to those who suffer. We pray especially for all those we've named on our prayer list, for the family and friends of Tom Werner, and for those we now name silently or aloud. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We give you thanks for those who carry out the ministry of hospitality, greeters, ushers, those who make coffee and bake cookies, all who welcome newcomers and care for children, and all who extend a hand of peace to neighbors. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You promise new life for all the faithful departed. Renew us in faith and hope until the day death is no more, when you will dwell with us in the new heaven and earth. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We commend these and all our prayers to you, O God. Come near to us with your saving help, for the sake of Jesus Christ, our risen Lord. Amen. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Please exchange that peace with one another. Let us pray. Blessed are you, O God, ruler of heaven and earth. Day by day you shower us with blessings. As you have raised us to new life in Christ, give us glad and generous hearts, ready to praise you and to respond to those in need. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, almighty and merciful God, for the gracious, glorious resurrection of our Savior Jesus Christ, the true Paschal Lamb who gave himself to take away our sin, who in dying has restored death, and in rising has brought us to eternal life. And so with Mary Magdalene and Peter and all the witnesses of the resurrection, with earth and sea and all their creatures, with angels and archangels, cherubim and seraphim, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." And we pray together as our Lord and Savior taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated.
Thank you.
please stand. The body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Amen. Let us pray. Life-giving God, in the mystery of Christ's resurrection, you send light to conquer darkness, water to give new life, and the bread of life to nourish your people. Send us forth as witnesses to your Son's resurrection, that we may show your glory to all the world, through Jesus Christ, our risen Lord. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.
Thank you.
Go now in peace to love and serve the Lord.